Hello, I'm Rhonda Garrison, Executive Director of the Corn Growers Association of North Carolina. We're excited to bring you the first of a series of videos that we'll be producing this year to help fill the gap left by the cancellation of field days due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Dr. Ron Heiniger will be joining us today, showing off some research that was funded with your assessment dollars through the Corn Growers Association. We would like for you to be involved in your association. If you have suggestions, thoughts, ideas, or would like to participate in any way, please feel free to get in touch with us. Thank you for joining us and enjoy.
People often ask me, how in the world do people like David Hula and Randy Downey get 400, 500, 600 bushel to the acre yields? What are their secrets? And of course, if I knew all their secrets, why, I'd be able to replicate what they do. But I am going to today talk about a secret that I think is fundamental to their success at those kind of high yields. My name is Dr. Ron Heiniger. I'm a cropping system specialist at North Carolina State University. And today we're going to look at the importance of an early start in corn. By early start, I'm talking about uniform emergence and quick growth up to V5 to V7 here. So today we're showing these plots here at the Maxwell Center here outside of Goldsboro. We're going to look at some treatments that illustrate how important that early start is. So I'm going to do two things here today with this video. Talk to you about the effects of that early start on corn and hopefully convince you how important that is. And second, how can we manage corn to get that early start? So let's take a look at some of these effects that I'm talking about. Here it is. This corn here at this site is at the VT stage here. It's in the middle of silking. Some of it actually has reached R1, where we've got 50% of those ears showing brown silk. So we're going to look at the effects now here at a critical time in corn development. Here on my right, your left, I have a plot that is Pioneer corn, 1464. Now that should say 38,000 if you can read that sign, seeds per acre. That's a mistake on my part. And it's got a little magnesium and some treatment there. But basically, it's the main thing about this plot is we did not use some starter fertilizer. You can see the height of this corn at this stage. And we'll look at that a little more detailed when we look at some of these plants here. Now compare that to this over here. This has got the same population, the same two treatments we looked at over there, but this sign lists one other factor, and that is some starter fertilizer, a 1027O, which has a micronutrient package called Rotec, and that fertilizer is applied at 20 gallons an acre. You can see the height of this plant. Now, today it's not clearly obvious that there's a huge difference, is there? You're going, yeah, I'm all impressed, Doc. But I'll tell you, when you looked at this corn here at V7 when we were laying by, and I've got some video we're going to show you here, you could say, like I did in that day, wow, what a difference. And particularly in a year like this, where we had cool, wet conditions early on, there was a huge difference in growth. And what makes that difference so remarkable is that that corn that you're looking at that stage was at the same growth stage. It had the same number of leaves. The difference was the size, the length and width of those leaves was remarkable. Now today, we still see those effects of what you've just seen there. We see the effects of both height and now the most important effects, both on root and ear development. So let's take a look at that here in a little more detail. Two good plants to demonstrate from these plots that I just showed you here. One, this is the plot that did not get the starter fertilizer. And here is the plant in a little more detail from the plot that did get starter fertilizer. You still see the height difference that still exists here. You might also see, and it'll be a little bit easier when we look at these ears, some difference in the stage of development. You notice these ears are still pollinating here. Here we've got ears with brown silks on them. So again, it's changed a little bit, the number of growing degree days required to reach that silking. Those are nice characteristics, but what really makes money, of course, is how many kernels it puts on that ear. So we can look at these ears now in a little more detail. Here's these ears from the plot that I showed you without the starter fertilizer. This is 38,000, so yes, that's probably too many plants for this Goldsboro silt loam here. But look at the size, they're not too bad. We've had a good season. But notice, here's one that hasn't still pollinated. We've got smaller ears here, so very interesting, the effect of 38,000 without the starter. Now let's take a look at these ears where we've got the starter fertilizer, and it becomes abundantly clear how that early start affected those ears. Look at the size, I can't even hold them in my hand. Look at how far along they are. This is already past blister stage here. So remarkable difference that all tracing back to that early growth that we had here in these plots and tracing back to this one treatment difference that we made here. We're gonna talk more about that in a little while. You might say, well, Doc, yeah, I'm all excited about that, but that's probably an unusual occurrence. Well, let's take a moment and look at another hybrid. Let's take a look at a decab hybrid here. All right, so we just looked at the Pioneer. Now we have a decab hybrid, the DKC6744. Let's see if indeed that early growth, that treatment growth difference made a difference in how it developed. Well, here we have the ears from those two, same type of plots, same treatments in those plots. Can you tell which side now had starter and which one didn't? I bet you can. Right there's the starter. There's the ears that didn't. So indeed, you can see here, even with this hybrid, what a tremendous difference it made. Now, there's one other aspect that's really driving this thing that I didn't point out with the Pioneer hybrid, and that is root growth. Here's the plant that had the starter. Here's the plant that grew slower. Take a look at those root differences there. That is really the crux to the issue. Because when it grows fast in the beginning of the year, it's not just growing above the ground, it's growing below the ground. So this is what's leading to these effects we're seeing. When you can put 38,000 ears in this field and make them look like that, that's high yield corn. So how does a grower manage your cornfield to get early growth like we're talking about and achieve the things that you're seeing in this video that we're able to achieve with early growth? Bigger ears, more kernels, more yield potential, bigger root systems here. And again, I've got a good illustration here. This is actually from a plot that the only difference here is a check has no other treatment and the treated is just that starter fertilizer that we showed you earlier, again at 20 gallons, at 1027 at 20 gallons to the acre here. So how do we achieve this? What can we do to achieve these kind of differences? Well, as you might guess, one issue is fertility. Now, I would say that was a key issue, but there is actually one issue that trumps fertility, and that's drainage. As good as fertility can be for you and as much benefit as you can get from starter fertilizer, that's what we're going to talk about, starter fertilizer, why drainage will trump that. So the first thing you need to do, can I get that water off in the spring? Drainage is key. But the second most important factor, and the one you've seen here today, is fertilizer. Starter fertilizer. Now, what makes starter interesting or important? It turns out it's all in the pea. It's phosphorus. Phosphorus is a unique molecule because a plant has to expend energy to move it from the soil through the root membrane and into the plant. That means in a cool, wet season like we had here this year, the energy required for that plant to make roots and then to pull that phosphorus is more than it's producing under wet, cool conditions. So you see phosphorus deficit. That's why we're seeing these big differences. It's phosphorus concentration around that seed area that allows that seed to pick up at phosphorus, and that is the biggest thing we found that will give you this early growth boost. Now, why is phosphorus so difficult here in North Carolina? Well, I've got a soil core here to illustrate what the issue is with phosphorus at planting. Most of us have good phosphorus in our soil, high levels. But what happens is that phosphorus in these sandy and even organic soils goes from the top to the bottom of the profile. So when you take a soil core like this, the phosphorus is all in the bottom of it. This area where your seed is going to be placed doesn't have very much. That's where starter fertilizer has to come in. We put enough phosphorus in this zone so that that seed sees phosphorus and is able to take it up immediately. Now you might ask, well, how much phosphorus? Well, I've got 20 gallons. That's a $60 treatment there. That's a lot of money to spend on starter. There's other ways to do it. In furrow, we found some benefits there. The key is concentration. However you do that. Now, I know a lot of you say, well, I'm using litter, and that helps, but it doesn't release enough phosphorus. Guys, I think in many cases, we're underestimating how much we need here. So don't skimp. A $20, $30 spent at planting time on a little phosphorus can be huge at harvest time. What else can we do? We've talked a little bit about the importance of drainage and phosphorus fertilizer in starter in getting this early growth effect and achieving what we want to achieve with bigger ears and higher yield. What else can we do? Is there something else besides spending money on more fertilizer? Well, we're looking at that. We've got a series of plots here at this site where we're looking at different treatments. You know, as I spoke earlier, the key effect is on these roots. And so anything that we can do to enhance growth of the root, and we've got a growth regulator treatment here, or the efficiency of the root. And that's the treatment we've got here. It's a product called Heat Shield. And what it is that it's endomycorrhiza that was applied at the seed area, and it inoculates the root system with mycorrhiza. And those mycorrhiza improve the efficiency. That helps that root reach out, gives it more opportunity to draw that phosphorus into that root system. So here's an example of a treatment that we think has some promise. Now, how much difference did it make? Well, you can see these roots. Not a huge difference in root growth. I didn't expect that to be the case because, again, we're applying a mycorrhiza. But look at the ears then. You can see that, indeed, we've got little bigger ears. So, indeed, that endomycorrhiza appears to have had some function in improving that growth in that plant. So, yes, indeed, as we look at this problem of creating bigger and better plants early in the season and how important that is in corn yield here, we're going to continue to make progress here. And I invite you to come by this site when you get an opportunity and see some of these differences we're talking about. Thank you for joining us and have a great day.
I'm Jay Sullivan. I farm in Sampson County, the neighboring county here, with my son Jarman Sullivan. We wanted to talk to you about the value of the virtual field days and the webinars and the YouTube videos that are been put up, some of it on the behest of the Corn Growers Association of North Carolina, which I am a member of. I'd like to encourage everyone to take a look at these videos as they go up. Ask your field crop agents all the questions you can ask about what's going on. We are always searching for good ideas for new research. The value of what we're doing or what's being done on your behest cannot be measured for the end profitability of your operation. We ask each and every one of you to please tune in, plug in, and offer any feedback you can.
Hello, my name is Wesley Stallings. I'm an area specialized agent for grain crops in the Southeastern Extension District for North Carolina Cooperative Extension. I'm here today with Daryl Anderson, who's an agent with Wayne County Cooperative Extension, and we work together to install our trials here at the Wayne County Maxwell Center.
Okay, my name is Daryl Anderson. Again, I'm the field crop agent here in Wayne County. And this site that you're looking at is actually it's the first year that we have put this site in. And we have three different corn trials and we have six different soybean trials. If anyone would like to come look at them, we'd love for you to come. And I serve the entire Wayne County and, you know, whatever farmers need, I try to take care of them.
And if I may add, I serve 18 counties and we have three of these host sites across the Southeastern District. One in Kenansville with a farmer and one in Robinson County with another farmer. That's very important for our grain growers throughout the Southeastern District that we're represented throughout the district, and that's a key focus of my position.